again, the level of importance. When was the last time you saw a fruits and vegetable commercial? Do you see those? Do you see those? When was the last time you saw a steak commercial? The last time you turned on the TV, right? So, one reason behind that, look up top, look at the money that's spent. Out of, and this was per 2012, 2013, so those numbers are definitely a little bit different, but only $116 million were spent on advertising on fruits and vegetables. All right, that might sound like a lot. It's like, oh, shoot, that's a pretty decent amount of money. But $4.6, almost $5 billion for everything else. So we know where the money is going, right? Next slide, please. Next slide. So when you look at a packaging, one of the first things, because of course, to get us to buy the package, we have to be attracted to it, correct? We're not going to go to no ugly packaging. Even if it had the best thing in the whole wide world, inside of it, the packaging is on the outside looks bad, we generally not going to go for it, right? There's a reason for that. Those colors that are up there do things to the mind. So what colors do you see most of our health food or quote-unquote health food packaged in? Greens. What is Kroger's Simply Truth? It's green and white normally. So if you look up there, green is peaceful. It does something to your head. So as soon as you see that packaging, you're automatically at ease. You're automatically saying, oh, that's okay. I can go buy that because it denotes health, it denotes peace, all those type things. Same thing for red. If you see something in a red packaging, Coca-Cola. Yeah, I'm happy to have that. You don't even think about it, but subconsciously, this is what our brains do when we see these packaging. So we already got things set up against us. We got it set up against us that a manufacturer is going to put just about anything in the whole wide world on a package. And then we have just how our bodies and minds react to the colors that are actually on the package, what they actually do for us. Next slide, please. Then we get to the front of the label. So now we have the color, which can throw us off. Then we have all the things that they can put on a food label or on the front package of our food. So heart healthy, maybe real, all this, that, and the other. Because the more stuff we see, the better it sounds, the more likely we are to buy those things, correct? Yeah, they look good. If it has some of those things on there, oh, it boosts my immune strength. I'm buying it. Don't even give it a second. Let me give it a second look. Oh, it's made with real this. Oh, I'm buying it. It's got to be good for me. So that's the second, that's the third, second, third thing that we have going against us. Again, we have the colors that the package uses, or the manufacturers use to package the food. Then we have the labels that are pretty ambiguous and tempt us to buy the food because we assume that the food is healthy for us. Is this making sense so far? Making sense? It's making sense so far. And for some of us, you know, this it plays out. The practical application of this is we're going to the grocery store and we got to choose between a couple of items. Do I get this? Do I get that? Because we're pressed for time, because we got this, that, and the other, we're going to get the thing that looks the best and has the most stuff on the front, correct? Under the guise that it's the most healthy for us, right?
Very good. Very good.
Supposedly. Supposedly healthy. Supposedly. Next slide, please. So when we look at a food label, because now we're like, all right, I know I can't trust what's on the front of the package. I can't trust my mind because the food packaging is a certain color and my brain automatically kind of wants it. So now I got to flip it over. But when you flip it over, you see a whole bunch of numbers that may or may not mean anything to you. Now, we don't have enough time today to go over exactly what all of this stuff means, but we can look at a few items. So if you look up there, you want to start where? If you're looking at a food label, where do you want to start? one top at the very, start at the very, very top. You want to look at serving size. That's really important. You want to look at calories per serving. You want to look at how many servings in a particular package. Those are three things. We can eliminate a whole lot of foods based off of just those three things right there. Just those three things. But the next thing you want to look at, what do we want to limit? We want to limit the fat, again, for heart health reasons. We want to limit cholesterol for roughly about the same thing. We want to limit our sodium for heart health and things of that nature, heart health, water retention, and a host of other things. Then you want to make sure that we get enough of our good things, whole grains, our proteins, fiber, things of that nature. So if you're looking at 5% or less, that's a pretty low number. So if you can look at the example that's up there, is that a low amount of the bad nutrients or a high amount? The bad nutrients? If you're looking at 5% or less, is considered low. If it says 5% or less, it's considered a fairly low occurring product in there. So total fat is what, about 18%? Ooh, that's pretty high. So if it's over that 5, that's not low. And we want to limit those types of products, right? We want to limit that. Now, if it says 20% of your, or 15% of your protein, that's probably a pretty good thing, right? So again, we want to limit the top couple of ones, the fat, the cholesterol, the sodium, and you want to see an increase in the protein, the fiber, and the vitamins and minerals that are on there. Does that make sense? Makes sense? All right. Next slide. All right. So now we're going to look into some real things here. I did this talk September of last year. I did a month-long health workshop here at church, and we took about an hour to about an hour and a half to go over some of this stuff. I'm trying to condense it all in about 20, 25 minutes. So this is some practical stuff right here. Let's take all the things that we learned a few minutes ago and apply them. First off, what's the coloring? What do those colors mean? Soothing, peaceful, inviting. So we're more than likely not going to even look at some of the nutrients. So we grab it. I'm going to make some soup. I'm going to use that, right? Next thing on there, what kind of marketing says it has less sodium? 33% less sodium, right? And so we're like, yo, I heard a talk about, you know, Dr. Crystal said something about sodium, and I know I need to decrease the amount of sodium in my diet. So 33% less has to be quite a bit, right? So color and the marketing already pulls us in, right? So now we have to turn it around. So if you look at that, that's 570 milligrams of sodium per serving. How many servings in that?
Two
servings. So that whole container has roughly a day's worth of sodium in it. But again, under the guise of doing something good, we get that not realizing the damage that we could be doing to ourselves. Because sometimes we'll use 2 or 3 of those in a week, because we either want to make soup, we want to do some green beans, we want to do something with our vegetables. So it's 33% less sodium. It has the good cover to make it seem like it's good, but it's not the best thing for us. A trick when you're looking at it, if you're looking for something that has low sodium, by law, it has to say low sodium. If it doesn't say low sodium, it's not low sodium. And low sodium means 140 milligrams or less per serving. That's go ahead. Mm-hmm. Less. And that's less than the original. So the original has about 900. And a lot of times that's what we're using, because let's not pretend it doesn't taste good. Right? So we'll use the 900 one, go and wonder why we have high blood pressure, while we have this, while we have that, because we're using a lot of those products. Does that make sense?
Yes.
This makes sense. That's why it's important.
It does not necessarily mean less than what's good for you.
No, it does not. It just means it's less than the original product. It's less than the original product. So there's no standard for that. They can say, they didn't even have to tell you that it's 33% less. All if they could have just put less sodium, that's real ambiguous. They don't have to say that. They could just say less sodium. They don't have to tell you the exact amount. And then we're going to assume that it's, oh, that's a healthy one for me. And it really is not. Next slide. Canned vegetables. Now, before I go further, canned vegetables can be a part of our healthy diet, correct? Yes, they can be, depending on what you need them for, depending on some people, some individuals' budget. This might be the best option for them. There's nothing wrong with buying canned fruits, canned vegetables. We just have to make sure we're getting what we think we are getting. So we have two of them that are up here. The top one, sliced carrots. Good, right? Carrots are good. But can y'all read that sodium number that's up there? 250 milligrams of sodium per serving. Now, I like carrots. Some of you all might love carrots. You all might go to town on that whole entire can of carrots, right? So how many servings? Can y'all see how many servings there are in that? Yes. 3.5 servings. So that whole can of carrots has roughly 800 to 900 milligrams of sodium in it. So again, now there's a way, of course, you can rinse some of that off. You know, if you rinsed it off, you would get some of it out, but some of it's already internalized on the product because that's how it was processed. So again, that's a big deal because we're supposed to only get 1,500 to 2,300 per day. Go ahead. Maybe. It depends. A lot of times people do, you could argue that frozen vegetables are better because they're flash frozen at the exact point of their highest point of nutrition. So in a lot of cases, frozen vegetables are a little bit better, but some of them do have sodium in there as far as the processing. And they also have, in a lot of frozen vegetables that I'm starting to see, they have sauce packets inside of them. And so, because you want the vegetable to taste pretty good, right? So they put a sauce packet in there, and we use a whole sauce packet, and the whole sauce packet is generally about a whole day's worth of sodium all in there. So that's another way of kind of adding that. But great question. Frozen vegetables are really good. They're really good for you. Now, if you go to the bottom, there are a couple of differences. It says no salt added. So whatever is there is naturally occurring. So that only has 10 milligrams of sodium. That's how important it is to look at the labels. Because those, one was on top of the other. So it was one level right here. I just looked at the one level below, and that's where the low sodium or the no salt added canned vegetables were. So you can find them. You just have to look, and we just have to pay attention. Because again, someone who is saying, well, you know, my doctor said I need to eat more carrots. It has vitamin A, has beta carotene, has this, that, and the other. Man, that's supposed to help me out. Has a lot of fiber, all those good things. But if we're not careful, we could be doing ourselves a disservice and being upset with ourselves and the doctor in the future, because we're going to go to the doctor maybe 6 months from then, going to town on canned vegetables and canned fruits and this, that, and the other, and you're going to tell your doctor, I did what you told me to do. I did what you told me to do. Why am I still in this predicament? It's because we were not paying attention to the labels. This is making sense? Making sense? Next slide, please. Uh-oh. Some of the drinks that we like to drink, some of the Powerades and the Gatorades and a lot of those things that we like. I didn't get these foods off the internet. This is what's being served and what's being sold in grocery stores and in restaurants. I got this at our downtown restaurant just for laughs. To kind of see. So that is a Powerade drink. And we would get that for what? Why would we drink that? We drink it for energy. We drink it because we worked out, you know, all those type of things. First off, if you're not working out, athlete hard, all you need is water. None of us in here need to drink that at any time. I'm sorry. Except if it's really hot, you hiking, you going this, that, and you with the Pathfinders, y'all hiking at 90 degree temperature, you might can get away with that. But for the majority of what we do, y'all don't need that. I don't work out hard enough for that. I don't. That is recommended for people who work out at a super high intensity for 90 minutes or more. Most of us are struggling to get 30 minutes. So this is what I hear. Man, I gotta drink one of those, man. I walked on that treadmill, man. I gotta recup. No, drink your water. But just to make it so we understand why this is not so great, we understand that we need between 1,500 and 2,300 milligrams a day. And honestly, most individuals say if you're African American or you already have a heart issue, you need to be closer to 1,500. 2,300 is the upper limit for our sodium needs. So that bottle is a serving, and that one bottle has 250 milligrams of sodium. And do we get less thirsty or more thirsty when we drink those things? So do we really stop at one? A lot of times we do not. So we can get a third of our sodium through that. Now, the next thing that looks pretty crazy is, look at the sugar in there. It's 34 grams of sugar. 34 grams. Again, we don't have enough time to go over all, you know, as far as how much, but let's just say that is roughly a day's serving of that. And now the second thing which we have to discuss, we have to look at our ingredient listings. That's important, but that's something that we can discuss at a totally different time. But that's just as important as looking at the nutrition label, because for me, some sugar is naturally occurring, some sugar is added sugar, right? That's just the new food labels that come out next year and the year after that will tell us exactly how much, but right now we just guessing. But I know for a fact that the majority of the sugar is in there is added because I looked at the nutrition label, and the second nutrient is high fructose corn syrup. So we're thinking we're doing ourselves real good, but the first ingredient there is water, then high fructose corn syrup. And if you listen to anything or anybody about high fructose corn syrup, we know how not so great that can be for us. So again, that's why it's important, because there are some people that go work out, drink that because they think they need it, because how many sports commercials, how many Gatorade, Powerade commercials do we see? Thousands, thousands. Did y'all hear the question? The question was, why do they have Shaq and Jordan and all other famous people telling us that we need to drink it? The same reason why if KFC came to Brandon and said, Brandon, we want you to push our new two-piece. We want you to tell you that it's good for a post-workout meal, and we're going to write you a check for $1.5 million a year. So my mind is like, well, how can I spin it to make it sound like it's a good post-workout meal? They're going to give me $1 million. I don't know. That's why. Because of money. So those manufacturers pay Shaq, Kobe, and all of them. Shaq makes anywhere from $30 to $60 million a year pushing products. They asked him to say something. What are you going to do? Yes, sir. I'm going to do it. So that is exactly, not because they're altruistic. We cannot assume that a manufacturer has our best interests at heart. As a matter of fact, we have to assume the opposite. Go ahead. No. No. They'll make healthy products if it's profitable for them. So now we're starting to shift just a little bit, and so they're starting to do a little bit better because we're more educated now, we're seeing stuff now, so there are more truly healthy products, but that's only because the market factors dictated that. It's not because they decided it, because it cost them a little bit more to make those products. It's cheap. High fructose corn syrup is cheap. Corn is cheap. So they're going to do the last, they're going to do that. All right, we got one more slide, one more. Uh-oh. Morningstar Farms. I love them. They are delicious. The one that I like the best, the one I got up there, is the maple syrup filled one. Man, I can go through a whole pack myself. They're good. But there are certain, this is where we talk about vegetarian food. Vegetarian food was just to be a bridge. Let me let that sink in for a second. Vegetarian food was designed to be a bridge. The bridge was meat products. Going from a total meat product-based diet to a plant-based diet is hard. So the vegetarian food was designed meat-based diet. Stepping stone right there to our palates change a little bit. And then we get into true plants, vegetables, this, that, and the other. That's the design for it. We've taken that and done different things with it. So when it comes to the Morningstar Farms, how many servings count as a serving? Well, what counts as a serving for the Morningstar Farms? One. One. Not two, not three. Those small little patties. One. How many come in there? Like eight? I can kill them by myself because they're so good. They got the syrup inside. They're good. They're good. So one of those patties, one. But let's just, for argument's sake, let's just say we just do two. We got to have a side of two, right? Because one just ain't going to do it. So one, 250 milligrams of sodium. So you're starting to see how the numbers start to add up over random stuff that we eat over the course of the day. Then we have our dietary fiber, which if it's a plant-based thing, it's supposed to have more than 1 gram of fiber in it. It just got one. So, yeah. Okay. So when we're looking at these numbers, when we're looking at these products, we have to recognize that Morningstar wants to sell us products too. These companies want to do this to us because of money. We have to look at the back of the food label, because if we do not, we could be doing ourselves a disservice under the guise of being healthy. Does that make sense? That makes sense, folks? All right, my time is up. Thank you all for listening. I'm going to turn it over to Uncle Joe.
We just hope that Brandon will come back and finish this out. We just didn't have the time to do it all today, but I think everybody will agree that what he's saying does make sense. We have to be mindful of what we put into our bodies if we want to be healthy and live longer. Do we have any visitors today? Anybody here for the first time today? Wow, I see three hands right here. Anybody else? How do we make our visitors feel welcome here at Magazine? We just want to tell you that we're so glad that you're here today, and we hope you'll come again. And if you're looking for a church home, we have a special place here just for you. So please come back and worship with us. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. God bless you.
We watch and we wait, Lord, we anticipate the moment you choose to appear. We worship, we praise until there's no debate, and we recognize you're already here. Hallelujah, you're already here. Hallelujah, you're already here. Oh, God, we watch and we wait, Lord, we anticipate the moment you choose to appear. We worship, we praise until there's no debate, and we recognize you're already here. Hallelujah, you're already here. Hallelujah, you're already here. Oh, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're here. The balm for my wounded soul.
Sabbath.
Sabbath. Good morning.
Can you please stand for the introit?
Come before His presence with thanksgiving. Enter into His courts with praise and be thankful unto Him. And be thankful unto Him, for He is worthy. Worthy of all praise.
Come before
His presence with thanksgiving.
Enter
into His courts with praise and be thankful unto Him. Be thankful unto Him, for He is worthy, worthy of all praise.
For the Lord
is good, and His mercy is everlasting, and His truth
to read responsively and responsibly, shout joyfully to the Lord, number 701. If you have it, will you say amen?
Amen?
Amen. I'm going to begin reading. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful singing. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and bless His name. Together, for the Lord is good. His loving kindness is everlasting and His faithfulness to all generations. Amen. Please bow your heads and pray with me this morning. Lord God, we thank You for Your many blessings, for Your grace and for Your mercy, Lord God, and how You've allowed us to see another beautiful Sabbath day. Now, Lord, we ask you to dwell here with us just a little while longer so that we may linger in the presence of the true and living God. We thank you, Lord God, for this and your many blessings. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Amen. Oh, that's pretty good. I have to ask you a second time. You did it right the first time. That means that you all are ready to sing 341, to God be the glory. Great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, whom yielded his life in atonement for sin and opened the life gate that all may go in. Hymn 341. We might have to kind of do it a little bit unassisted initially, but we'll be okay. Page is not turning anymore. Are we ready? Okay. To God be the glory. Ready, sing. To God be the glory. Great things he did. Pick it up a little bit. So loved he the world. Look after thee. He gave us his. A little bit more speed. No, thee. Did his life and atoned for sin and opened the floodgate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father. Son, and give him the glory, great things. Very good. Verse 2. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of the vilest offender, who truly believes, that moment from Jesus, a pardon receives a pardon. Praise the Lord. Let's bring it out. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the Verse 3, great things he has taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus, but purer and higher, and greater will be our wonder, our transport, and Jesus we see. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he had done. Amen, amen.
Good morning, magazine, and happy Sabbath to everybody in here. Yes, I would like to acknowledge the visitors. We have any visitors today? Would you please stand up? How do we treat our visitors? We welcome you here today. We hope you will come back and make this your home, as we wish that you enjoy this service, and we thank you for coming. In the name of Jesus Christ, we give blessings all to all in the church. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Charles. Aunt Janice, if you would please, has an announcement this morning.
Good morning, church. I come to you representing the Justice Ministries, known citywide as CLOUT. I know some of you have probably wondered, what does CLOUT stand for? Well, it's the acronym for Citizens of Louisville, Organized and United Together. Our goal is to unite the citizens of Louisville to address injustice in our community. And one way to do this is for all of us to come together collectively and to make our voices one voice and to present those issues that we have to our city leaders. The biggest opportunity that you have in order to do that at this point is to attend the Nehemiah Assembly. We've been talking about that now for, well, quite some time. About the churches, there are 21 churches throughout the city of Louisville who have come together to fight injustice. And we've selected an issue which we've been talking about, which is the issue of mental health, mental illness, as well as addiction, and how those paths cross when it comes to the criminal justice system. On Tuesday, March 28th at 6:30 p.m., the Nehemiah Assembly will come together at the Memorial Auditorium at 4th and Kentucky, and each one of you is invited. There, the issues that I've just mentioned will be presented to our city officials and to let them know of our concerns, as also to make suggestions for solutions in providing adequate resources for the mentally ill, the addicted, and those who find themselves in the criminal justice system because of those two issues. And I can't say enough, I've said it over and over, numbers count. We need each of you to come out and support this effort. Nothing is required of you, absolutely nothing. All you need to do is to come out and attend, and the representatives from the organization will present those issues to our city officials. Team members and network members at this church have been calling you to encourage you to come. Some of you have noticed our numbers on your phone and you don't answer. That's not good. That's not good. So we're asking that you will reconsider coming to the meeting. So when someone calls you and asks you if you will come, please say yes. You have to have a ticket in order to get in so you can see Lassie LaRue, Sharon Carney, Yvonne Lovell, or me. To get a ticket, you have to have one in order to get in. But please say yes if someone calls you. If you have received a call already and you haven't returned the call, or you're thinking, I don't know if it's important or not, please make the decision that you will attend the Nehemiah Assembly. And one last thing I want to say to you, as I always do, numbers count. Numbers count. We need as many people to turn out for the assembly as possible. God bless you, and thank you so much for your support.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Aunt Janice. Let's say amen for our Clout Ministries for being involved in the community like that and taking part in that activity. Amen. I had the blessed privilege of attending the Nehemiah Assembly last year, and it was not just our turnout was a blessing, but to know that our presence there was to help bring about change in our community, the city where we live, was truly a blessing. So if you have been invited to that event, we want to come out and attend that and try to support that effort. Well, good morning, church family.
Good morning.
I know it says Pastor Luckett in your bulletin, and while we are in the same height class, I am not he. I can say that this morning because he's not here. He's at New Life this morning speaking, and I know a few of our church family are there this morning, so we want to remember to keep him in prayer as he worships with them this morning. But it's still Sabbath, church, and I'm glad about it. Amen. Today is a beautiful Sabbath day, and I might be a tad bit biased because today is my birthday. Amen. Amen. Now, another part of that is that I don't share this month by myself. Unfortunately, I would like to, but there are other people born in the month of March. So if you had a March birthday, would you please stand to your feet so your church family can acknowledge you this morning? I know we have a few. Amen. Remain standing, Dr. Crystal, please, and thank you. Amen. Frazier behind me. Amen. Amen. Now, as our birthday people are standing, if they would please give us a smile. Would you guys model a smile for us this morning? Amen. Amen. Dr. Crystal, you know, yeah, she's smiling. So if you would you all please stand and smile like Dr. Crystal is smiling this morning? And please, let's move from your seat. Let's greet each other this morning with a smile, a shake, and a hug, and just accept. But thank God that we're all here today. Amen. Thank you.
Sabbath, everyone. Could you please remain standing and join us in praise and worship? We're going to sing a really easy worship song. And it goes, My God reigns, our God reigns, Lord, you reign above everything. And it's really funny, sometimes when I'm praying, I stop and think about what was I doing at this time 7 days ago. No hurt, harm, or danger has come up on me. I haven't missed a meal. My car, it rolls. It gets me to point A to point B. I come back home, find everything safe. And it is so much stuff that's going on in the world, and we are all affected by it. Maybe not directly, but indirectly. You might know somebody that's going through something. But God continues to bless us and to keep us. And I just want to publicly say thank you. And you guys are here every week, so I know you feel the same way I do. Might not be on your faces, but I know that he is blessing you because I see you here today. So come on and join us. God reigns, our God reigns, Lord, you reign above every name. My God reigns,
my God reigns,
our God reigns,
our God reigns,
Lord, you reign above every name. Say, our God reigns,
my God reigns,
our God reigns,
our God reigns.
Say, Lord, you reign above every name. Say, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Say, Lord, you reign above every name.
With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign.
Oh, say, my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Sing, Lord, you reign above every name. Yeah, yeah. My God reigns.
My God reigns.
Sing, our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Lord, you reign.
Above every name,
with power
and majesty,
dominion
authority,
you reign. Yeah, yeah,
with power and majesty, dominion authority, you reign.
Above every name. circumstance.
Over my circumstance.
You're giving me another chance.
You're giving me another chance. You reign.
Over my circumstance.
Over my circumstance.
Giving me another chance.
Giving me another chance. You reign.
Worship the Lord in prayer. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7 says, "Cast all your cares upon him," that's the Lord, "for he cares for you." Cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. If you're worried about something today, cast your cares upon him.
Yes, sir.
You got more bills than money? Cast that care upon him. You got marital problems? Cast that care upon him, because my God cares for you. If you're feeling heavy and burdened down, God will lift that burden because he cares for you. You may be sitting in your seat with bowed heads. You may want to come to the altar. But I promise you today, as I pray aloud and you pray to yourself, the God I serve will answer your prayer. And as you are praying, there are some people I want you to include in your prayer today. Remember Sister Hood and her family. Remember Joanne Smith. Her son, Aaron, has to have open heart surgery. We don't know the date yet, but please pray for him. He has asked that the church pray for him. I also ask that you remember Sister Bard and her son in prayer. Remember Pastor Howard's mother. Remember also the young man, he's been here about 2 weeks. His name is Bobby Burma. He's in the hospital. He will be back to take Bible studies. Man. Even if you don't pray for yourself, pray for Bobby. He happened to just stumble up on the Adventist church, and he wants Bible studies. Remember him in prayer. Remember Elder Mallett's brother, Harold. Keep him in your prayers also. Brother and Sister Mickens, even the caregiver, Connie. I'll ask, Lord, that you remember each one of your brothers and sisters here in Christ as we bow our head to lift each prayer request and remember the ones that are in our bulletin. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with all our cares, our worries, our brothers and sisters, even the weight of the world that's on some of the people's shoulder, because, Lord, we seem like we have gone mad. We just ask, Lord, that you continue to look down on us be with us and keep each and every one of us. Each household, Lord, that are struggling with their children, their marriage, their financial problem, whatever it is that they're worried about, Lord, you have promised us in 1 Peter 5:7 to cast all your cares upon you. Cast all of them, all our cares. And Lord, you will provide for us. As we hear with our heads bowed, our mind reflect upon the various ones that have lost loved ones. But you know what, Lord? You have kept them close. You have never left them. You don't leave them. You are here with your children. Because, Lord, without prayer, who do we have? Where can we turn to? Lord, we need you. Remember each and every name that's listed in our bulletin today, Lord, that are sick and shut in. And Lord, for the names that I did not call, I was not aware of, I ask, Lord, that you would be with them. You know, because Lord, you know all. And we thank you for that. You have brought us to another holy Sabbath. We say thank you for that, Lord. You brought our first elder to another year of a birthday, and the other members, you gave them another year to continue to worship you. And we say thank you, Lord. Keep us, Father, for we cannot keep ourselves. I pray for the speaker of the hour today, Lord, that you would be with Frazier in a way, Lord, that each and every one of us here that's going to be on the sound of his voice, that he has been to the mountaintop with you, that we can leave this place saying it is good that we have been in the presence of the Lord. Bless us all again. It's my prayer, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning. Today I am 33 years old.
No.
Thank the Lord. I'm first of all thankful that I still pass. Somebody asked me if I was 22 today. Thank you very much. But no, I'm truly, truly thankful. I remember as a younger child thinking that 33 was old. And I remember I can very clearly hear my great grandmother in my head saying, "Keep living, baby. Keep living." And I've done a little bit of living since then, and I'm thankful to know that God is faithful. God has never kept me, never left me, never forsaken me. God has been a friend that sticks closer than a brother. God is a promise keeper and a way maker, and I am thankful for those things. As I was getting up this morning, I was thinking about just my whole life and these 33 years where God has blessed me. And I used to say very out of habit, very easily, I'm thankful for life, health, and strength. It's easy to say that, right? Thankful for life, health, and strength. But it's not till you get sick, when you have a little test, a little circumstance, that you can really, truly say, I am thankful for my life. I am thankful for my health. I am thankful for the strength, and praise God for the activity of my limbs. God has been good to me, and I know he's not just been good to me, because the great thing about him is he's been good to you too. He shares. Thank you, Lord. So if you have something to be thankful for this morning, if you just have one thing that you would like to praise God for this morning, I ask that you take an offering. Meet me down front at this little house, and let's give God a little thanks of how much he's done for us and how grateful we are to him for all that he has done. Gooder to us than we could ever be to ourselves, Lord. But we thank you, God, for being good. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your peace. We thank you for your long suffering, Lord God, with these old sinful creatures called us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you put up with us, that you love us, you clothe us, you feed us. Thank you, God, for your blessings to us. We could not say it enough, Lord God, if we had 10,000 tongues, if we all said it at once, we could never say thank you enough, God, but we do. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen.
Fill this place.
Let your glory fill this place.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Let your healing star right now.
Let your healing star right now.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Let your glory fill this place, yeah.
Let your glory fill this place.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Let your healing star right now.
Let your healing star right now.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Let your glory fill this place, yeah.
Let your glory fill this place.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Let your healing star right now.
Let your healing star right now.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Shekinah glory come on
Sing
down.
Oh, be God in this place. Be God in this place. Help me sing, oh.
Oh, be God in this place.
You can be God.
Be God in this place.
Say, oh,
oh, be God in this place.
Yes, be God.
Be God in this place.
Let your glory fill this place, yeah.
Let your glory fill this place.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Let your healing start right now.
Let your healing start right now.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Let your glory fill this place, yeah.
Let your glory fill this place.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Show your hand of mercy upon us.
Let your healing start right now.
Let your healing star right now.
Shekinah glory come on down.
Shekinah
Peter 5, 7 about worries. We're going to conclude it with our tithes and offering and giving. What qualifies a worry? Anything that takes your joy. Something that you cannot change. Something that you're not responsible for. Something that you are unable to control. Something that keeps you awake at night when you know you should be sleeping. I'm going to tell you this. You be faithful to God, He'll be faithful to you, and He'll take all that away. Think of it this way. Money can buy medicine, but it won't buy health. Money can buy a house, but not a home. Money can buy companionship, but not a friend or friends. Money can buy food, but not an appetite. I thank God for my appetite. Money can buy a bed, but not sleep. Money can buy a good life, but not eternal life. It is all up to God how we choose to live and how we choose to serve Him. God supplies all the things that we need and give us the joy that we need. Money has never made anyone rich. Psalms 50:10 says, every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon a thousand hills belongs to the Lord. He said, if I was hungry, I wouldn't even tell you. In other words, let's look at Psalms 24:1-4 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all they that dwell therein. Who shall ascend into the hills of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Bring all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And prove me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, today and every day, Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you have given us. Lord, you have asked us to be faithful in our tithe and offering. And we can be witnesses to that of how you have led in our life. Father, I ask today, whatever is worrying or bothering our people today, I ask them today to cast it upon you and bless this tithe and offering. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God from whom we
Mercy! Told me I may not have no more birthdays. They said your heart is so bad we can't do nothing with it. But for his goodness and his mercy towards me, I don't know why, but I'm sitting here today. And all I can say is his goodness is good. His mercy endures forever. Good afternoon, church. It's a pleasure to come before you today. Pastors over at New Life celebrating their homecoming this morning, and I have the opportunity to come before you today. And I'm blessed and honored. I want you to turn to a very familiar passage in your Bibles. Psalms 23. Psalms 23. And we want to look at verses 1 and 2. Psalms 23, verses 1 and 2. And when you have this, you can say, "Frazier, I got it." And stand to your feet. And we will read these two verses together. Beginning, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters." Please bow your heads and pray with me as we consider for a few minutes. In good hands. In good hands. Dear Father in heaven, Lord, we're so thankful for your presence in your place today. And we ask that you dwell here with us, Father God, as we look into your word. Be in my mind and in my mouth and in my heart, Father God, as I present to you, to your people, what it is that you've helped me to prepare, Father God, and be in their minds and in their hearing and in their hearts, Father God, that they may hear what it is that you want them to hear this morning. Father, we take this opportunity to say that we love you. We thank you and we place no one above you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Please take your seats. This is perhaps the most well-known passage of Scripture in the Bible. It's no secret. It is the passage most taken out of context or least misunderstood. The author is very familiar to us. It is David, King David. The same David that killed Goliath, the same David that ran and hid from Saul, the same David that committed adultery and murder. What we often forget is that before any of these things came about, David was a shepherd tending the herds of his father's sheep. In fact, David's bravery was birthed and developed during his shepherding days, as it is recorded that he slew a bear and a lion in defense of his father's sheep. David was trained well by his father and older brothers in the techniques and skills of shepherding. It is very interesting that David chooses to draw the analogy of a shepherd's care for his sheep and God's care for his people. One thing is for sure, David knew all that was involved in shepherding. Now, David's audience was a simple nomadic people of his time that were familiar with nature and the outdoor life of the countryside around them and had some idea what shepherding was involved. We certainly don't fit in that category. Most, if not all of us, are from an urban environment. We're city folk, unfamiliar with crops and land and wildlife and pure nature. In this microwave era, we don't know the first thing about taking care of sheep. What do we know about pastures or valleys or shearing sheep? What do sheep like to eat? What is the significance of still waters? Just what does being a shepherd entail? Well, let's follow our scripture and get an idea. The Lord is my shepherd. What Lord? Why do I need a Lord? What gives him authority to be my boss? Well, why do I need a shepherd? I thought a shepherd was the sheep. Well, what is a Lord? A Lord is a person that has authority, power, or control over others, a person who is a leader or a feudal superior. Now, when I said, what Lord, somebody said, our Lord. In here, that makes a lot of sense. But out there, it's kind of ambiguous. So what Lord are we talking about? David said, well, whoever it is, he had a lot of confidence in him. Psalms 27:1 says, the Lord is the light of my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Now let's look at Psalms 148:1-5. This will make it real, real clear. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you stars of light. Praise him, you heavens of heavens, and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded, and they were created. David is talking about our Creator. He is specifically talking about the Lord Jehovah. Of that, there's no question. But what gives him authority to be our Lord? Well, he made us. We are his. We belong to him. W. Philip Keller says in his book, A Shepherd Looks at Psalms 23, that in this sense, first of all, I am basically bound to admit that his ownership of me as a human being is legitimately legitimate simply because it was he that brought me into being, and no one is better able to understand and care for me than he is. I belong to him simply because he deliberately chose to create me as the object of his own affection. It is patently clear that most men and women refuse to acknowledge this fact. Their deliberate attempts to deny that such a relationship even exists or could exist between man and his maker demonstrate their abhorrence of admitting that anyone can claim ownership or authority over them by virtue of bringing them into being. Now that's deep. That you know that this person created you, but yet you deny his authority. Okay, so he made us. Why else should he have authority over us? John 3:16 says that, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." So he gave his only begotten Son to die for our sins, so he's paid a second price. And yet there's another price. He continues to intercede for us endlessly right now. And if you ask me, there's a fourth price he's paid that he has yet to pay. He's coming back to get me. I don't know about y'all. Y'all don't sound too convinced out there, but he's coming back to get me. And if I go by myself, that'll be all right. That'll be more mansions for me. The relationship described to us between God the Father and ourselves repeatedly in Scripture is that of a father and his children and a shepherd and his sheep. This is a good place to know that the relationship between God and his sheep is found some 30 times in the Bible. The Bible mentions, "Care for my sheep which were lost. Sheep, hear my voice. Tend my sheep. Shepherd my people. Shepherd my sheep, to shepherd the church, to shepherd the flock of God. I am the good shepherd." Paul called him the great shepherd. Peter called him the chief shepherd. So this is a point to define what a shepherd is. The shepherd is a person who herds, tends, or guards sheep. That's obvious. A shepherd is a person who protects, guides, or watches over a person or a group of people. A shepherd is a member of the clergy, like our pastor. Or a shepherd is the shepherd Jesus Christ. Now, why do sheep need shepherding? This is going to be good. Sheep by nature are stubborn and hard-headed. It ain't over. Sheep by nature are afraid. They're timid. They are mass-minded, and they are stupid. Stupid. I didn't make that up. That came from research. Stupid. So the question begs, why do we need shepherding? Somebody said we're all those things. We have the very same traits. The Lord is my shepherd. Now, the Lord is my shepherd is not a question. It is not some blatant statement. It is a bold proclamation. David is boldly stating that the Lord is his shepherd. Here, David, a shepherd himself, defines himself as totally dependent on the Lord. Now, by this point in life, David has a mature relationship with the Lord. And he knows the value of that relationship. Now, are we dependent on the Lord? Are we? You better believe it. "I shall not want. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Now, that's bold also. "I will lack nothing." I may not have what I want, but I have what I need. And I lack nothing. I will be fed, kept, protected, and well managed. Well managed. The good shepherd manages his sheep well. Not only that, but because he is my shepherd and I love him and I trust him, a second emphasis is the idea of being utterly content in the good shepherd's care and consequently not craving or desiring anything more. Now, we get in trouble there. We get in trouble there. Not being satisfied with what we have and where we are and wanting what somebody else has or what they show us on TV that we ought to have. That new car that if you make $350 a week, we'll sell you a car, but that note's gonna be $500 a month. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I ain't gonna call out no brand names or nothing. Somebody might be listening. Why should I be content with what my shepherd provides? Who knows more about what I need than who made me? Who knows more about guiding me towards my goal than he who came to show me the way? Who knows more about guiding me towards the throne of God than he who sits at the right hand of the Father right now? Who can better guide me? Who's out there that can show me the way to heaven better than Jesus can? Now that's if I want to go to heaven. Anybody want to go to heaven today? Amen. All right, I thought I'd get an amen on that. But that does not mean that we will not experience problems or troubles. Who wrote this? Who wrote this song? David. What did he go through? Just with Saul. Hiding, ducking, dodging. His life in risk, danger at every side, and yet he is able to write, I shall not want. Though I'm going through these things, I'm okay because I know I'm in good hands. My shepherd will take good care of me. Look at Abraham, Noah, Moses, Jacob, Joseph, Daniel, and look at Job. Job says in Job 13:15, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Going on into the New Testament, look at Paul and Peter and John and Stephen. Look at Jesus himself. Jesus says that in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Being in the flock does not mean that dangers and troubles will not persist, and I'm a witness, but because I am in the care of my shepherd. See, my shepherd ain't like their shepherd. I don't even know if my shepherd's like your shepherd, but my shepherd takes good care of me, and because I'm in his care and all hell is breaking loose, I'm okay because I know he'll take good care of me. Now, Mr. Keller says, based on the teaching of the Bible, we can only conclude that David was not referring to material or physical property when he made the statement, I shall not want. For this very reason, the Christian has to take a long, hard look at his life. He has to recognize that with many of God's choice people before him, he may be called to experience a lack of wealth or material benefits. He has to see his sojourn upon the planet as a brief interlude during which there may be some privation in a physical sense. Yet amid such hardship, he can still boast, I shall not want, I shall not lack the expert care and management of my master. I want to get the point across that David is proud to say that the Lord is my shepherd. This is something that he takes good pride. He stands on top of a rock somewhere shouting this. And because he's my shepherd, I shall not want. There's nothing that I shall lack. Anything that I need, he's going to give me. Any situation that I find myself, he's going to take care of me. Whether times are good or whether times are bad, he's going to take good care of me. Another way of looking at this is to examine what the Bible says in regard to prosperity and riches. Just because a person is prosperous and times are good does not mean that they are under the watchful eye of a good shepherd. Look at Revelation 17:17-19. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. And look at Matthew 10:21. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. We are expected to live modest lives. We are expected to be content with what we have. The author of the Psalm, David, is saying that he is content. David is saying it's not the fact that I am the king that gives me peace. It is not the fact that I possess great wealth that gives me joy. It is not the fact that I am famous that makes me feel good about myself. It is because I have a shepherd that loves me above all else and delights in managing my every need and gave his life for me. That gives me courage, confidence, and strength. I'm in good hands. Our author says I'm completely satisfied with his management of my life. Why? Because he is a sheepman to whom no trouble is too great as he cares for his flock. He is a rancher who is outstanding because of his fondness for his sheep, who loves them for their own sake as well as for his personal pleasure in them. He will, if necessary, be on the job 24 hours a day to see that they are properly provided for in every detail. Above all, he is very jealous of his name and high reputation as the Good Shepherd. I'm in good hands. To get a clear appreciation for this, consider being in the care of a bad shepherd. Consider being in the care of a bad shepherd. How does that sound? How does that look? Does anyone in here know what it's like to be in the care of a bad shepherd? I don't expect any answers, but I'm just saying. One that promotes chaos, one that did not provide green pastures or even clean water. How would that be? Would you rather belong to a good shepherd or to an imposter? God demands a good shepherd. Jesus delights in being the good shepherd. Now, when you get home, or when you have the opportunity, I want you to take the time to read Ezekiel 34:1-16. Here God has told Ezekiel, that's Ezekiel 34:1-16. Here God has given Ezekiel a word to tell the shepherds of the land, I'm tired of y'all. Y'all not taking care of my people. You're fat, you're rich, you're well clothed, you're well taken care of, but my sheep are sick, my sheep are broken, my sheep are scattered all over the place. And no one's trying to take care of it. So y'all just stand aside. I'm going to take care of them. This is God saying that I love my flock well enough that, okay, y'all go on about your business. I'm going to take care of this. No longer can I afford my sheep to be managed badly. So I will seek what was lost and bring back what was driven away, bind up the broken and strengthen what was sick. But I will destroy the fat and the strong and feed them in judgment. Jesus says in John 10:6-16, this parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things which he spake to them. Then Jesus said unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever come before me are thieves. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for his sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them and scattereth them. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Let me paint a picture from Mr. Keller. And this is the life of a shepherd. See, we have no idea of what being a shepherd is or what a shepherd does from day to day. We know what it is like to be like on our job and what we do when we hit the clock and we go through about our business, but we don't know what a shepherd goes through. It's particularly during that time. See, even now shepherding is different. They got helicopters and four-wheel drives and they barely use dogs even anymore. But in those days, from early dawn until late at night, this utterly selfish shepherd is alert to the welfare of his flock. For the diligent sheepman rises early and goes out first thing every morning without fail to look over his flock. It is the initial intimate contact of the day. With the practical, searching, sympathetic eye, he examines the sheep to see that they are fit and content and able to be on their feet. In an instant, he can tell if they've been molested during the night, whether any are ill, some of which require special attention. Repeatedly throughout the day, he casts his eye over the flock to make sure that all is well. Nor even at night is he oblivious to their needs. He sleeps, as it were, with one eye open and both ears open, ready at the least sound of trouble to leap up and protect his own. He that keepeth thee will not slumber or sleep. I'm in good hands. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. How does he make me do anything? What's so important about green pastures? Lie down. How does he lead me beside the still waters? Still waters versus what? What do we mean to be made to lie down? Is it a forceful making? The good shepherd makes it possible for them to lie down. See, there are four requirements that must be met for a sheep to lie down. Must be free from fear. Cannot be afraid to lie down. They must be free from friction. No, this is a good one. Listen now. They must be free from friction with others of their own kind. Sheep must be free from pest. And they will not lie down if they feel in need of food. If a sheep is under the impression that he is in any kind of danger at all, he will not lay down. If he is in, as long as there's the slightest suspicion of danger from dogs, coyotes, cougars, bears, or other enemies, the sheep stand up ready to flee for their lives. They have little means of self-defense. They are helpless, timid, feeble creatures whose only recourse is to run. And if one runs, they all take off. That's that mass-mindedness. If one of them hears a stick crack, he's gone, and the whole herd is gone in every rich direction because they don't know where the danger is coming from. A flock that is restless, discontented, always agitated and disturbed never does well. And the same is true of people. How able are we to concentrate or to focus on the task at hand and to excel and to relax if we are living in fear, worried about something, or agitated from within or from without? And we share that pack mentality with sheep. If one is agitated or afraid, it causes discourse in another. And the sheep know the voice of their shepherd, and his very voice and presence provide comfort and peace. Knowing he is there provides peace and assurance even though calamity is apparent. And the same is true with us. Knowing that the shepherd is there, knowing that the Lord is there, knowing that the Holy Spirit is there gives us peace. They must be free from friction from their own kind. In every animal society, there is an established order of dominance, a pecking order, if you will, or horning order, or butting order. Tensions and frictions with others of their kind, a pecking order. Who will be first? Competition, resentments, bitterness, jealousy. Our author says, because of this rivalry, tensions and competition for status and self-assertion, there's friction in the flock. The sheep cannot lie down and rest in contentment. Always they must stand up and defend their rights and contest the challenge of the intruder. Conflict and jealousy can be very detrimental. The sheep become edgy, tense, discontented, and restless. They lose weight and become irritable. They're not managed well. And when they see the presence of their shepherd come into view, they forget their foolish rivalries. Isn't that true with us? When we allow the conviction of the Holy Spirit to prevail, isn't that true with us? That all of the things that we think are so important and so worth fighting over are just put in the proper perspective, and we're allowed to be at peace and we're allowed to be calm. But whenever the shepherd comes into view, they forget their foolish rivalry. The shepherd's presence makes all the difference in the sheep's lives. They're in good hands. In any business firm, any office, any family, any community, any church, the human organization or group, be it large or small, the struggle for self-assertion and self-recognition goes on. Most of us fight to be top sheep. We butt and quarrel and compete to get ahead, and in the process, people are hurt. In contrast, the psalmist shows God's people lying down in peaceful contentment. Paul says, I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be what? Content. And this certainly applies to our status in society. But if I'm actually doing the best that I can do, how much time do I have to worry about someone else's life and what they have and so on? That's just a question I'm saying. Sheep must be free from pests, especially in the summer. They can be driven to absolute distraction by nasal flies, bot flies, wobble flies, and ticks. When tormented by these pests, it is literally impossible for them to lie down and rest. Instead, they are up and on their feet, stamping their legs, shaking their heads, ready to rush off into the bush for relief from the pests. A good shepherd will simply apply various expensive chemicals, oils, and balms. The sheepman must be about his job every day. Contentment among his flock must be his priority, or else his flock will not do well. As soon as he detects that they are pestered in any way, he must take steps to provide relief. There are all sorts of small and not so small irritations in our lives. The good shepherd is quick to come to our aid. In fact, the relief from these irritations is always available to us from the Holy Spirit. That's why he left us a comforter, because he knew we'd be pestered. He knew we'd get on each other's nerves. Did I say that? The Holy Spirit is referred to as oil, which brings healing and peace. It sometimes soothes irritations. It brings quietness, serenity, strength, and calmness. When I turn to him, I expose those irritants to him, and in his own wondrous way, he takes over. I am then able to lie down in peace and rest. Aggravated by flies or parasites, take time to see what's bugging you. Just take time to see. Like Elder Hardy was talking about earlier, if you're not able to sleep, if something is bugging you, find out what that thing is and turn it over to the Holy Spirit. And lastly, they will not lie down if they feel the need of food. Simply put, if they're hungry, they're not going to lie down. And some of us won't lie down if we don't eat something too. And that's why some of us have, I ain't going into that. Now, I need you to know that green pastures don't happen by chance. David wrote this psalm, and he was a shepherd in Palestine. And flocks near Jerusalem is a dry, brown, sun-dried, and burned wasteland. So to produce green pastures, tremendously hard work and tremendous skill was required. Rough, dry, and rocky terrain had to be cleared. The ground had to be tilled and plowed. Careful preparation of the soil, irrigation, and then planting the special grains and legumes that are necessary for the proper development of sheep for the good shepherd. We are like that. Hard, lifeless, dry, rocky land. Because of our own perversiveness, we often prefer to feed on the barren ground of the world around us. But the Good Shepherd has supplied green pastures for those who care to move on to them and find peace and plenty. How he works to clear the life of rocks on stony belief. He tries to tear down the roots of bitterness. He attempts to break up the hard, proud human heart that is set like sun-dried clay. He then sows the seed of his own precious word, which, if given half a chance to grow, will produce rich crops of contentment and peace. He waters us with the dews and rain of his own presence in the Holy Spirit. He tends and cares and cultivates a life longing to see it become rich and green and productive. Only the shepherd can meet these needs. The sheep can't do this on their own. The things that we need in our life, we can't produce on our own. Our jobs don't provide what we need. It is the Lord that provided that job in the first place. Only the shepherd can meet these needs. We're in good hands. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Now sheep will not drink from a rushing brook or a rushing stream. They need still, peaceful, clean water. And the shepherd has to provide that. If there's a pond or a lake in which the sheep may drink, he has to take time to clear that area from around that area so that the sheep can get to it. Without adequate hydration, the body of the sheep becomes desiccated. It becomes weak and impoverished. Water makes up approximately 70% of the animal's body, helping to maintain metabolism, turgidity, and normal biological function. Now, if the sheep are not provided the good, clean water they need, their drive of thirst will lead them to drink whatever is available, regardless of the purity of the water. They will drink from polluted potholes, where they can pick up parasites, liver flukes, or other disease-carrying organisms. And it's the shepherd that has to provide here. That is the key. He must provide this. In the same manner as sheep and humans require physical water, we require spiritual quenching as well, as that only can be quenched by drawing on Jesus. To drink here means to take in or to accept or to believe. Blessed are they which thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. We're in good hands. What are we thirsty for? Are we thirsty for peace, hope, joy, acceptance, love, belonging, purpose, power, fame, or money? And where do we search for the quenching of this thirst? Reminds me of a song, "Looking for Love in All the Wrong Places." It is a compelling picture. It is an accurate portrayal of broken lives, of shattered hopes, of barren souls that are drained up and parched and full of dust and despair. Among young people, especially the beat, that's interesting that he used the word beat. This book was written close to 50 years ago, but he used the beat generation. He must have known something. The recourse to drugs, to alcohol, to sexual adventure in a mad desire to satisfy their thirst is classic proof that such sordid indulgences are no substitute for the spirit of the living God. These poor people are broken cisterns. Their lives are misery. I have yet to talk to a truly happy person seeking relief in these ways. Their faces show the desperation within them. And amid all this chaos of a confused sick society, Christ quietly, as of old, invites us to follow him. He invites us to put our confidence in him, for he it is who knows how we can be satisfied. He knows that the human heart, the human personality, the human soul, and its amazing capacity for God can never be satisfied with a substitute. And as strange as it may appear on the surface, the deep wells of God from which we drink are not always necessarily the delightful experiences we imagine them to be. It's not easy following Christ sometimes. It's not easy being a Christian sometimes. The author paints this amazing picture of geography. Rock trails formed by centuries of rainfall and water drainage along its natural course, all leading to a particular shepherd's well in Africa. But yet this well is inaccessible to the sheep. So the shepherd has to take off his gear and go down into this gully and into these narrow passages and bail the water out to get to the sheep. To bail this clear water out to get to the sheep. The sheep otherwise could not get to this clean, pure water. And again, this is totally dependent on the shepherd. If it weren't for the shepherd, they would not drink. Now, why would he work this hard? Why would he work this hard? Many of the places we may be led into will appear to be dark, deep, dangerous, and somewhat disagreeable. But it simply must be remembered that it is he that is with us. He is very much at work in the situation. It is his energy, effort, and strength expended on my behalf that even in this deep, dark place is bound to produce a benefit for me. Now, I gotta take time to tell y'all a story. I was in the hospital. And this was in October, and I was waiting on my heart. And one particular morning, I wasn't feeling well. And Phyllis called me, and we talked for a minute, and I told her, I said, I wasn't feeling well that morning. And after we talked, I put my phone on silent, and I went to sleep. And I woke up several hours later, and I was shivering. Shivering as hard as I had shivered ever in my life. And they took my temperature, and it was 99.1. I had a low-grade fever. And they gave me some Tylenol, and I went back to sleep. And I woke up again, and I was shivering even harder. And they took my temperature, and it was 103.1. And they said, well, you must have an infection in your bloodline somewhere, because I had lines coming out of my neck and lines coming out of this arm and lines coming out of this arm. And I looked at my phone, and Phyllis had called. And I don't remember, did I call you back? I didn't call back. I was so sick, I didn't call back. I just laid in bed just shivering and shaking so hard that it hurt. That physically it hurt. And the nurses were calling people from different areas, and special nurses were coming, and the, directors were coming and they brought in the code card, and I'm like, what are y'all doing? What's going on? And they said, and the doctor came in and he said, you're going into septic shock and your heart is so sick and you've got this infection going on and I'm laying in bed and I'm shaking and I'm shivering and I'm like, Lord, it's what's going on? I wish Phyllis was here and I was by myself, and lo, I heard this set of footsteps. Phyllis was supposed to be here. She was supposed to be in Louisville. It was the time, we were doing the time of the Revelation Seminar, and Gloria Stokes was here, and Gloria said, I'm worried about my brother-in-law. I'm going to see him. Just on a Hummer, they said, we're going to Louisville. And they got in the car and came, and we're going to Lexington. They got in the car and they came to Lexington. And I'm going through all of this, and I'm by myself, and I hear this set of footsteps, and I said, that sounds like Phyllis. You know, when you're married and when you love somebody and when you know somebody well enough, you know that walk. You know that walk, and I knew that walk belonged to my baby. And she came in the room wondering what was going on because she saw all these nurses, and Gloria was behind her, and Sister Bennett was behind her, and Phyllis came to the right side of the bed while they worked on me on the left side, and Gloria and Sister Bennett were over there in the corner just praying and calling on the name of Jesus, and they had the pads hooked up to me like they were getting ready to shock me. I passed out for a minute, they say, and I came back too, and while I was passed out, they were getting ready to shock me, but before they could shock me, I came back too, praise the Lord, and they gave me some antibiotics, the shivering stopped, and in the midst of all of that, in the midst of all that chaos, my shepherd was there. He was there with his staff, guiding and leading and pulling people from Louisville and pulling in the right doctors and pulling in the right nurses and giving me the right medication and helping them to make the right decisions. So I don't want anybody in here to be dismayed about where you are in life. You may not be on a hospital bed. It may be your finances, it may be your work, it may be your relationship, but I'm telling you that in the midst of it all, God is there. It is there that I will discover that He only can satisfy me. It is He who makes sense and purpose and meaning come out of situations which otherwise would be but a mockery to me. Suddenly life starts to have significance. I discover I'm the object of His special care and attention. I need you to know that 2 weeks later I had my heart. 2 weeks later, after being in the hospital only 3 weeks, I had my heart. Praise Him. I discover I am the object of His special care and attention. Dignity and direction come into the events of my life, and I see them sorting themselves out in a definite pattern and usefulness. All of this is refreshing, stimulating, and invigorating. My thirst for reality in life is satisfied, and I discovered that I have found that satisfaction comes from my Master alone. I'm in good hands. So as I wrap up, we have established several positive points. The relationship of God as shepherd to man. The Lord is my shepherd, and I'm proud of my shepherd. Since He is my shepherd, I shall not want. He gives me peace to lie down in green pastures. He works hard to develop and keep these pastures green. He is the good shepherd, delights in being so. He dutifully protects us from any adversaries. And he provides me with clean water. And when times are dark and when times are bad, he's there in the midst of them. So if God is so good to us, why do we turn our backs on him? What do we want? It's like the pastor said last week, the Lord has a design for us, but we want what everyone else has. It's as if the Lord, our shepherd, is working so diligently on our behalf that we're standing at the fence looking at the grass on the other side of the fence. We have the good shepherd, the great shepherd, the chief shepherd, and we're looking on the other side of the fence for a shepherd that we know nothing about. Like considering Babylon, wondering what it would be like. Well, I can tell you, don't wonder. It ain't worth it. Some of us have been in Babylon and we still look at the other side. God, our creator, has a system in place. He longs to be our shepherd, to provide us, provide for us, to protect us, to lead and guide us, to give us something to be proud of, to differentiate us from everyone else, to be a particular people. Don't you want to follow him? The doors of the church are open. And maybe today you're saying, Lord, you are my shepherd, but I've gone astray. I know which way I'm supposed to go because you've shown me. I know which way I'm supposed to go because I see you and I know I'm supposed to follow you, and yet I've gone astray. And if that's you right now, I just want you to be prepared to come down and to pray with the elders as they come down. And maybe you don't know the shepherd. Maybe you're wandering aimlessly throughout life, going from here to there with no direction, with no purpose. And you need a church home today. And you need to belong to a flock. We give you the invitation to join us. And if you're one of those that has gone astray, the elders are here now to pray for you, to pray with you. Won't you come? Won't you come?
When the song is over, when the music stops, do you know Jesus?
Do you know him?
Does he live in your heart? When your life is troubled,
the shepherd
Jesus
is waiting.
Still wants to be a part. Do you know Jesus? Does he live in your heart?
Is he calling you right now? Is there one?
Does he live in your heart? Do you believe? was born. Do you believe that he died?
Won't you come?
Do you believe your sins can be forgiven by the blood from his side? Do you believe the love can reach you right where you are? Do you know Jesus?
Is there anyone else?
Does he live in your heart? Oh, do you know Jesus? Does he live in your heart?
Shepherd longs to have all of his flock under his care. He takes pride in protecting, providing for us.
When the song is over, when the music stops, do you know Jesus? Does he live in your heart?
And if you need a flock this morning,
when the life troubled,
the door
Jesus
is open.
Still wants to be a part. Do you know Jesus? Does he live in your heart? Do you believe that he was born? Do you believe that he died? Do you believe your sins will be forgiven by the blood from his side? Do you believe his love can reach you right where you are? Do you know Jesus? Does he live in your heart? Oh, do you
is there anyone
know
else?
Jesus? Does he live in your heart?
Anyone else? Is there anyone else before Tiffany gives benediction? Please bow your heads with me in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you so much for your presence here today. We thank you, Father God, for your willingness and your pride in being our shepherd, Father God. And we ask you, Father God, for the wherewithal to be humble enough to follow you, Father God, to drop the stubbornness and the hard-headedness, to drop the stupidity, Father God, and the mass-mindedness, and to not be afraid, Father God, for you are with us, Father God, through all of the calamity and through all the chaos. And Father, we just want to thank you for taking time to want to be our shepherd. We thank you for what is going on in this sanctuary today, for those that have come down for prayer. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
This morning? Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Frazier. If you would, please stand to your feet as we prepare for our benediction. Brennan? You have an announcement? Okay. Let's reach across the aisle and touch the hands of someone next to you.